In the second half of our symposium, it's a pleasure, as Tobias said earlier, we'll have with us Andrew Jones, Zaha Hadid, and Lebel Woods will be talking with us online from New York. So it's a pleasure to have and to introduce it to you, Andrew Jones from San Francisco. I don't think I need to say much because I think the presentation will say it all. He's a digital painter, creative, and founder of Massive Black San Francisco. Please, welcoming and joining Andrew Jones.
Thank you very much, Ricardo. I just want to start by saying what an honor it is to be speaking in front of all of you guys today. When I was first invited by Tobias and Ricardo, my first speculation is that they must have had the wrong Andrew Jones when they made the invite. There's actually another Andrew Jones that works in the film industry that worked on Avatar. And I graduated from an art school called Ringling School of Art and Design with a BFA in computer animation and fine art. And 2 weeks before I received this invitation, I had a very enthusiastic invitation from Ringling asking me to speak on behalf of Avatar. And seeing that my only experience was watching on an IMAX, I wasn't really prepared. So you can imagine, as soon as I got this invitation, after being very thorough and going back and forth and making sure that they had saw pictures of me and videos, and once I was really confident that they did invite me to this presentation, then I gleefully accepted the invitation. So, yeah. It was I'd start with an interesting story. As I landed yesterday at Heathrow, I was reminded of my first experience here in London. After graduating from Ringling, I took an internship at Industrial Light and Magic, and then I accepted a concept design job in Los Angeles. And after working in LA for about a month and spending what seemed like most of my life in traffic and having my soul sucked from me a little day by day, I quickly quit that job and took my last paycheck to follow a lifelong dream of coming out to Europe with a French easel and a handful of charcoal to draw street portraits to support myself. I'd never been out of the country before, and so London was my first destination, and I was just full of young enthusiasm and idealism, and I checked into a modest hostel and went down to Piccadilly Circus, Piccadilly Square, and set my little easel up. And within 6 hours, I found myself in the police station, where I was threatened by being arrested and deported for illegal street trading. So you can often see the irony of being invited back under such different circumstances. It's a real pleasure to come back here and join you here in this forum. So, start off with a little bit of my work. I support myself now as a fine artist. Let's start with this image. Between the years of 2003 and 2006, I embarked on one of my first, what I would call real artistic journeys, where I created a self-portrait of myself every day for 1,000 consecutive days in a row. And it was towards the close to the 900s, I started to fall prey to an obsession and a psychosis, and so I quickly stopped that project. And it was inspired by a web community. Here's an example of one of the portraits. It was inspired by a web community that I started called conceptart.org. It's an online art community, and we fluctuate between 180 and 190,000 registered members. And from here we launched a series of workshops and exhibitions and digital downloads, and right now we're actively about creating an online art school called TAD, which is the art department, which started in a similar fashion as I believe this school did, which is a bunch of artists that were not happy with the way that art was being taught, and so we're trying to create our own environment around that. From conceptart.org, I started a studio called Massive Black. Massive Black is known in the industry as, it's concept art, it's an art outsourcing studio for concept art, and we are one of the secret weapons of the film and game industry, and also we've been called the Black Prince of the conceptual art world. And it's an amazing studio. We house 17 in-house artists in San Francisco. We've got around 45 artists in Shanghai. And we handle everything from commercial work to video games to film. And yeah, it was an amazing experience for me to be part of a community. Communities are a big aspect of what I'm about and how I support other artists and within the community. So I'm just going to quickly go through some of the art that I do now. Now I left Massive Black to embark on my own fine art career. And as I'll go through some of these images, these are examples of the work that I exhibit in galleries. A lot of the themes of my work, one of the major themes is beauty. I really try to create work that empowers people. I've spent a lot of time, I've logged a lot of hours in the, I have a deep interest in the shamanic experience, and I've traveled to many jungles and deserts and logged a lot of hours in yurts and sweat lodges and different ceremonies to gain a lot of the inspiration I have for not only being an artist but a human being. And I have used those experiences to for my inspiration in a lot of the fine art work that I do. I print out a lot of different materials. This one's printed out on a mirror. I still do dabble in traditional art when I'm feeling highly romantic and indulgence, but I do find that the majority of the work that I do create now is digital. It's an example of a piece printed out on glass. This is a Christmas card. Ever since I was in first grade, I create a Christmas card for my mother every year for Christmas, and this was the latest example of the cosmic Jesus, which I recently found on someone's blog post, their blog posting under the Antichrist, which I wasn't too thrilled about. Here's some more of my abstract work. I threw this one in for Ricardo. This was a commission. I do a lot of book covers and album cover art, and this was for a band called Soulfly, which is the main lead singer, Max Cavalera, is a big inspiration of me and Ricardo, so I definitely wanted to throw that one in there. Like I say, I really, the element for, I found that before, during Massive Black, a lot of the art that I created was done on my own in my studio, dealing with a lot of issues that a lot of artists face, like insecurity and fear. And because of those experiences now, I really try to infuse my art with a sense of celebration and inspiration. This was a drawing that was actually done while I was in an ayahuasca dieta down in the Amazon. And then I took it back, scanned it in, and painted it digitally. So experimentation is a huge component of the work that I do, where the artists and that I've always looked up to throughout my life, the famous masters, they were, when I look at the limited tools they had, you know, they were, the technology that was available to artists back then were the dead hairs of an animal and crushed pigments of the earth. And I find it to be an exciting opportunity and almost an obligation to really explore what digital art has to offer. Here's a small sketch that I'm working on. I still do dabble in the organic work, and I definitely keep a dedicated sketchbook to myself. This is, you can see at the bottom, it's kind of an example of a pseudo architecture. A lot of the programs I use are Photoshop, mainly Corel Painter, and ZBrush for a lot of the modeling that I do and some SketchUp. I work a lot with I'm really inspired by the feminine and the principle of the divine feminine. And I found that these images of the forward facing female, it really has the ability to activate people and to draw them in to look at more of the work. Here's just an example of a recent show that I had in San Francisco. And some album cover work that I do. And most of what you just saw were the studio work that I do. And ever since I left Massive Black, I've throughout my career, I find that I'm constantly evaluating where I'm at and trying to reinvent myself and how I appear as a creative being in the world. And after I left Massive Black, I had a huge opportunity to do whatever I really wanted. And in San Francisco, I'm part of a community where there's a lot of musicians and DJs and performers, and I love going to these events and seeing people that are able to really share their art in the moment with people. And so I had an opportunity. I had a friend that was a DJ that invited me to go on tour with him, and he basically gave me carte blanche to participate in any way that I wanted to. And an idea that I had for a long time is that at all the electronic concerts and things that I see, there's always a component of visuals that are there. And usually they border from, you know, little video clips to, you know, screensavers. And so I saw an opportunity there for me to do what I do. And so I started what I call the live digital painting. And that involves me setting up on stage with my laptop on a tripod. It allows me to work anywhere. I recently did I had a visit with Craig Mullins out in Hawaii, and it allows me to pretty much make my studio anywhere that I want. This is out on the rocks of Maui as we painted waves in the sunset together. A lot of times I'll work from models as an example of me in one of my art workshops. I'll work from live models. I'll work with the music as the inspiration. I'll work with the environment as an inspiration. A lot of times we'll have different costume models. And the principle that I try to bring out in the idea of live painting, but obviously any drawing you do is going to be live. But what I focus on and what's really inspired me is the vulnerability of putting yourself out there in front of sometimes 5 to 10,000 people at once and working on that edge. You know, a lot of times when you're in your studio, you're by yourself, you're isolated, you can concentrate, you have your music. But I find when I'm using and able to harness the energy of thousands of people that are focusing their energy on the stage, I always start off with a blank canvas, and I found that some really interesting things can develop. This is me really feeling it out in a show I did in Los Angeles. It can become quite a spectacle sometimes when the music is right. Also really feeling it too with my Wacom tablet. And these are an example of the live paintings that I've done. Making the break out of the studio opened up a whole new realm of inspiration and possibility. This was a live painting that I did out in Shambhala in Canada as the sun rose. When I was out there, I realized that it was I'd been a digital artist. I started embarking on my digital journey in 93, and this was done 2 years ago. And as I was out there in Canada in the Rocky Mountains watching the sunrise with thousands of beautiful people out in front of me dancing, I realized that was the first time I'd ever actually drawn a sunrise from life. You know, the opportunity was there the whole time, but it took me traveling all the way to Canada and hauling all of my gear out in the middle of nowhere to actually seize that sort of opportunity. And I think those are the possibilities that the live art enables for me. This is at a festival called the Boom Festival, which I'll talk about a little later on. A lot of times I'll work all through the night. I'll start off a painting. You know, since it's projected, it always needs to start after dark. But there are times, this one I worked all the night through, where I started at the bottom and worked my way all the way up to the top to capture the sunrise over the hill. This is done in Costa Rica. This is one I did in Australia. I set up on top of a warehouse, and from left to right, I painted the sunrise into the night and into the sunset on one morning/evening. This is done out at the Burning Man Festival, which I'll talk a little bit more about later. I work with a lot of trying to capture it's a beautiful opportunity to actually capture artists in the midst of what they do. This is an MC called Nikila. This is an artist named Bass Nectar out in Chicago. And sometimes I really just dive as far as I can into the abstract. When I'm working with abstract, I'm always trying to discover and experiment with shapes and color and form and to push depth. And I'm always looking for new and novel combinations of these shapes and all these elements together that create something that that captures my attention and that I find interesting. It's an example of a work that I did. There's a poet and a wordsmith named John Perry Barlow. He He was one of the founders of the Grateful Dead. And this is an experiment where we were in my studio and he would create poetry during the evening and then I would create art. And as he saw the art projected on the wall, it would inspire his poetry. And so the fusion of combining different art and different artists from different disciplines has always really interested me. This is one in Montreal. I did a tour through Japan. This is one with Mixmaster Morse. This is another DJ I toured with in Japan called Blue Tech. This is out in a festival called Lightning in a Bottle out in Santa Barbara. This is Oregon. I believe this was the winter sunrise, this winter sunrise solstice of 2009 out in Berlin. Another one in Japan. You see, again, just really working with that element of the dynamism of people in motion and moving. I find that I'm lucky enough to be part of a subculture where there's so many exciting new breakthroughs in music and creativity all happening at once, and it's a real honor to be a part of that. And a lot of the times I consider myself kind of a cultural stenographer of sorts by capturing the energy of a crowd in a way that I found that no camera, no video equipment is ever capable of doing. This was from the photo you saw earlier of my setup out in Maui, capturing the sunrise. This was a very chaotic New Year's in San Francisco. This was done out at Burning Man. This was Kentucky. This is an interesting one. I had the opportunity of participating in a festival in Brazil. It was a New Year's festival, and I painted this as the sun was rising on the first day of the new year in 2009. And this works with a lot of the influences I've had through my shamanic experience working with the animal totems, the masculine and the feminine, the eagle symbolizing the masculine and the hummingbird symbolizing the feminine. This was Sunset Out in Australia. This is another one with a DJ I worked with named Bass Nectar out in Australia as well, in Brazil. And so that concludes most of the live stuff that I've done. And because this is obviously an architecture school, I don't have a whole lot of experience with architecture, a lot of the disciplines of accuracy and vectors and math and perspective are usually things that I try my best to avoid. And so I did search my portfolio for anything that resembled any type of architecture. This is a project that I'm working on now for it's called the Temple Entertainment Complex in downtown San Francisco. And it's a 55-foot, it will be a 55-foot backlit digital mural. And the idea that the owner commissioned was to create a very futuristic version of San Francisco from basically kind of from where my house is in Berkeley. And here's some close-ups of this. This concept and involves a lot, a high degree of speculation about what the future might hold for the constantly redefining itself as the Bay Bridge. It's part of Midtown and a farther aspect of the show. I do employ a lot of 3D work and the 3D programs into my work. This is done with a program that I'll show you a little later on. It's a new type of dynamic painting application that I've been working on, where all of these strokes there, all the brushes are driven by dynamic particles. So instead of actually, where before I was painting with shapes instead of just like the dots or the traditional circle and square brushes, this actually allows me to paint with dynamic particles. Another exploration into the abstract. Yeah, and this brings me to another one of my projects. This is, how many people in the room, since I come from San Francisco, I'm a little, I'm overexposed to it, but I'm just curious how many people in the room have heard of an event called Burning Man. Oh, good, that's a good number. I actually didn't intend to have any slides on Burning Man, but after Ricardo gave me a tour of the amazing facilities here and seeing all the projects, I was just so reminded how similar a lot of the sculptures I was seeing could fit into a place like Burning Man. For those that that don't know, Burning Man, it's a social experiment of sorts that happens every year in the Black Rock Desert. And it involves 50,000 people from all over the US and many parts of the world congregate in this prehistoric dry lake bed where not even insects can survive. And we create a city together over 9 days. This is a top-down view of the city from an airplane. And it's a non-commercial event. No money is involved. You're not allowed to buy or sell anything at the event. It's all around a gifting community. And it's, at times it reminds me of, it's almost like a apocalyptical training camp, because everyone gets the experience of relying on themselves and each other for support. And when it's not the apocalyptic training camp, it's like a 24-hour talent show / science fair. But it enables a platform for people to really express themselves and their individuality, where everything is allowed and everything is okay. And it congregates around this, and this is the man. This is a 50-foot tall neon wooden sculpture that the festival culminates around, and on the last day everyone gathers around and we set the man on fire together. So you can overlay your own metaphor for how powerful that can be, with 50,000 people burning this effigy of a man in celebration. One of the elements of Burning Man, after the man burns, there's a temple that's created, and it's a ceremonial temple that exists behind the man. And where the man is part of the celebration, the temple is where everyone goes to, if you've had loved ones that have passed, you go to this temple and you can write their name on the temple or bring their pictures. And it's a very cathartic experience to watch this temple burn. And 2 years ago, I was approached by the temple building team to create some of the inspirational drawings for the temple for them. And because it was a huge undertaking for them, they have basically 2 weeks to create a 50-foot tall structure in the middle of a desert with little resources. They were very intimidated by the project. And so I created this concept for them, and I made it. And the concept, I set it on fire so they could speculate, and they would be able to see this image and project themselves into the future and imagine that it was already finished and burning, which is the place that they wanted to be on that. And so by creating this image, it really infused them with a lot of inspiration how to move forward. So this was the drawing, and this was the actual temple they ended up building. All those, the poles that you see there are actually recycled telephone poles. So, kind of like the sketch, a little bit. Like I said, not incredibly accurate. But one of the most satisfying experience of seeing these things built is then watching it burn afterwards. I totally got the fire wrong. For some reason, I forgot that they set it on fire from the bottom up, and so that was my one big mistake here, but pretty close to it. This is a shot from the inside of the temple, and it was just beautiful to see, because even though we had some drawings and we had some layouts, so much of this, the construction occurs organically. The name of the structure was called Basura Sangrada, which means sacred trash, and every aspect, none of the components besides the nails were anything that was bought. It was all made out of recycled material and trash and things from estate sales and reclaimed objects. This is an example of some of the other sculptures you see out in Burning Man. And it's really a place where the creativity and the imagination are so encouraged to really flourish. And these particular, some of the, these are, this was the temple last year. And when I saw a lot of the sculptures here at school, I put these slides in because I was reminded of what these guys are doing out there. As you guys can see, this is an example of my roommate's sculpture. His name is Michael Christian. This is Burning Man at Night. This is a temple from, I believe, 2007. And you can just kind of imagine the CNC hours that had to be put into creating something like this. A structure made just out of 2x4s and nails. Another shot of the temple last year. This is one of the camps that I was with last year at Burning Man. and all those structures surrounding that. As far as architectural influences, Buckminster Fuller is one of my all-time favorites, actually. I'm the proud owner of a 16-foot geodesic dome that's my kind of apocalyptic plan B if anything goes wrong. And they created all these structures out of wooden pallets surrounding this area. And so this brings me to the next project that I'm involved in right now that actually does have to do with some architecture. This is the Boom Festival. Has anyone heard of the Boom Festival? Excellent. Well, please allow me to be your neo-tribal underground ambassador of this very special event. This Boom happens every 2 years in Lisbon, Portugal, under the full moon between August 18th and 26th. And there's a very masculine component about Burning Man, and I would say that Boom would be the feminine component of this event. And I was able to participate in it 2008, the last year that it happened. And this year I was invited by the Boom team to join them to be one of the lead visionaries of designing the dance floor that they have, the main dance floor. There's five dance floors they have, and they have one main dance floor. And this is an example of the dance floor from 2006. This is the lake where Boom takes place. And this was my task this year. This is the dance floor. What excites me so much about these events, which you're looking at over 26,000 people. You know, what this project was for me, it was the ability to create a container. You know, I've seen a lot of different things in my life, and we live in a very interesting world with so many dynamics. And Boom is the one place where I can be part of and experience over 26, when you're surrounded by 26,000 people from around the world, from all different countries, all different languages, all different religions, all different philosophies, all together, unified, dancing to one beat, celebrating the joy and the creativity of the human existence. For me, it's the closest thing that I've ever experienced to what one could call a world peace, if that's even a possibility. And so for this project for Boom, I really considered that what I'm designing is a container for this fragile moment of world peace that exists out there. This is an overview map of where Boom will take place this year. It's another shot of the massive dance floor. And this is the dance floor from 2006. And so these are some of my initial concepts for the festival. What really made this project new for me is that a lot of the times as a concept designer, I'll create a very complicated and intricate design, and then I have the pleasure of just handing it over to other more responsible people to actually execute my ideas. And unfortunately, it's a situation where I wasn't that fortunate, and I actually have to oversee the entire construction from start to finish, to grommets and nails and budgets. And so it was a really interesting opportunity to work with an actual practical guidelines of what's possible with our resources. A lot of the main tenets of Boom is consciousness and spirituality and sustainability. This dance floor, this is a top-down of the design of the shade structure of the dance floor. And this is my design for what we're calling the DJ temple. It's based off a stiletted dodecahedron, where you can see inside here, this is where the DJ, the main DJ booth will be. And what I wanted to create was this sort of an altar that will focus the energy of the 27,000 people into the DJ, because what happens at the events, there's this amazing kind of a cyclical, symbiotic relationship between a DJ, a music producer, that's putting his energy and this music out through this giant sound system, and it's going into the ears and the minds and the hearts of all these people, and he's able to receive the energy back, and it's an amazing dynamic to watch. And so my intentions were to create this particular container to focus all of the energy into the DJ, so he can put his efforts into the crowd. This is a concept of how I would imagine the DJ booth looks during one of the peak elements of the festival. When I was approached with the project, it was really challenging just to kind of start off from scratch and see where to go. And so what I did is I took the experience I have from going to these events and live painting and imagined myself in the crowd and what would I want to paint ideally if the festival was already happening. And so this was one of the first images that I created there with smoke machines and lasers and lots of really fun stuff. This is a design of the main stage during the day. I've got some of the elements and the components I'm working with. This is a, you can see on the side, these are two sculptures that are made by hand by my roommate. These were just featured in Coachella a few weeks ago. You can see there are these massive amoeba-type structures. And inside here, a lot of the principles I'm working with, the triangle and hexagon and the tetrahedron, I feel they're very simple, basic shapes that people can, you know, apply their own archetypes and mythology onto afterwards. And so that wraps up Boom. And the when it came to the nature of speculation, I wanted to, this is another kind of a side project I'm working on called Mio. And when I think and when I speculate about the future and what it holds, there's my mind goes somewhere between Hopi prophecies in 2012 to the idea of us going back to a tribal stone age, kind of to put it in film terms, almost like a Mad Max, and then on the opposite end would be, you know, crazy visionary Tron is where we might go. And so Mio would be one of my highest imaginations of where I see the current trends in social networking and technology coming together. So this is a completely speculative project. If you can imagine a platform like a Facebook, you know, I think it's easy to see with where technology is going at an exponential rate that it's only a matter of time before it goes into a 3D realm. And instead of interacting with a two-dimensional image and the planes that you're actually, you would control a 3D avatar in space. And so this is an example of the Mio avatars, where every instead of like the Second Life where you kind of create more of like a character, every facet of the character here is made up of photographs of you, you know, and the character is based around all your own interests. Here is an example of an editor that you create. You would start off as actual a particle in space, and the commodities that you develop, you earn triangles and vertexes. And so the more you participate in this universe, the currency is the more geometry that you're allowed to express yourself, where we can start seeing communities creating virtual environments where you'll be able to host events. This is an example of the expanded hypergraph of your possibilities in Mio. I'm trying to, when I envision these sort of things, and also and a lot of times when I envision my own art and my own, you know, where I see myself in the future, I try to imagine myself as what a 9 or 10 or 11-year-old is going to expect when they're my age. And so that often makes me create completely unreasonable scenarios, because I think that's the only way that it's actually going to happen. What I want to create things that these are the type of devices and elements that I think that the younger generations are going to expect there to be in the future. So overwhelming amounts of information and data all processing at the same time. These are examples of smaller fodder characters that would be within there. And one of the ideas that I would have would be the ability to have events in this virtual space. So this would be an example of a concert or a workshop, based even partly on my experience of being an artist and the struggles of being able, it always fascinates me that based off the world politics, there are places that I am and other artists are allowed and aren't allowed to be. It seems really barbaric that we still exist within that framework. Part of the concept of Mio is creating a virtual space free of any sort of borders or visas where artists and people are allowed to trade their art and their music and their data as commodities in a virtual world. There's some more examples of kind of architecture and abstract environments you would find in this sort of environment where there's no rules, where you can design without gravity. Example of like a virtual concert where a DJ would project himself into this environment and all the users would log in and attend these virtual events in real time as they happened. This is kind of an idealized concept imagination of the freedom that human beings will be able to experience in this sort of environment. And this brings me to another project that I'm involved in now, and it's called Phaedroid. It is an evolution of where I was going with my live painting. I find that it's amazing to create a painting or an image and put it out on the internet and speculate the impact that it has on people. You know, and you receive emails and feedback and forums, but I find that there's such a potent value to actually delivering something to people in the moment, and I get such a charge out of that performance element of giving everything I can in one moment to people. A lot of the art that I do it's all based around one of the main components is contrast. I'm always trying to find a way of contrasting different elements together. And Phaedroid is a project that I started in February of 2009 with what is now my wife. Phaedra, she's Phaedra. I go by Android a lot of the time, so Phaedra and Android, we decided to be Phaedroid. And I have a video I'll show you in a moment. It's a live act where my wife dresses up in white and dances, and I project onto her with a dynamic particle engine. And what we aim to do is to divulge and show part of the invisible realms that we're not able to see that exists when a human being is moving in space. I think one of the things that make Phaedroid a very interesting experiment is that it combines, on my level, you know, the highest degree of technology that I can afford, you know, with the Wacom tablets and laptops. Phaedra, she studied India. She studied dance in India for 9 years, and I think if you look at all the different ways that human beings can express themselves creatively, that dance would be probably one of the most primal. It's the least technological of almost any creative expression besides voice. And so to combine the most cutting edge projections and digital tools with this archaic form of dance, to combine the masculine and the feminine, to combine the syntheticness of the digital media and the analog of her movements, we find that this has the ability to really help activate people. Its goal is to inspire and open people's minds. And that's one of the things that I believe that technology can allow. When you combine technology with human creativity, I think that there's the alchemical opportunity to really expand consciousness of human beings. And that's one of the avenues that I'm devoted to as an artist, and how I can mix these things together and elicit the most response out of people. And here's a couple still shots of us in action. And if you would indulge me, I have a short video that I'd like to play for you guys. So this is, we use a lot of different technology. What you're about to see is us, we've teamed up with a team called Obscura Digital, and their setup allows us to project on a Musion screen, which is actually a holographic surface that is projected on in front of the viewers. And so everything you're seeing here, it's all the raw footage. The only change I made was some dissolving back and forth of some of the different scenes. So this is fake. What you're seeing there is, as she dances, I'm able to follow her with this. This is Ricardo really insisted that I bring this out to show you guys. This is my oversized A4 wake on. I call it my divine tablet of manifestation. And it allows me the luxury of being able to create in any situation that I want. I can able really put myself into it. It's kind of like a digital electric guitar. And what I just wanted to show you just super briefly, the last thing when it comes to speculation about the future is the area that I'm really focusing right now is the children. I did an event with NASA last month, where I brought out the Wacom supplied several Cintiqs, and I was able to debut this program that I'm working on to share with children. This is a two-year-old that is making an abstract painting with this program that I developed. At 2 years old, she needed no instructions. She immediately, there was no lag, there was no, you know, trying to convince her what it was. I find that the young minds are completely able to adapt to this digital technology. And part of my ongoing thesis is that the true digital revolution will definitely start with the children. It's really in the last moments. This is the program that I'm working on right now. And what this allows me to do is to create these dynamic particles that I can move and shape around. I recently started getting into I'm sure from designers, that is it the Fibonacci spiral. And so when my wife Phaedra dances with this, she really starts. One of the goals is to have her dance start turning into math. And as a painting application, I have the ability to keep these things on screen. And when I brought this out in front of the children, they immediately, without any sort of instructions, they immediately took to it in a second. And so it's part of my goal of developing this type of a program, and alongside with Wacom technology, is that I believe that these sort of applications can be, and my goal is to make the new gateway drug of digital art for the next generation. Okay, thank you very much for your time. Thank you for having me.
It's an honor to have here with us Zaha Hadid, the founder of the Seminal Architecture Office, Zaha Hadid Architects. So I think there's not much to say, but just to look at her work and listen to her fantastic career and be reminded where everything started, and to hopefully listen a bit more at where it's going as well. So please, joining me, welcoming Zaha Hadid.
Yeah, my career started with this podium since 40 years ago. Brett, you can't have someone talking with this machine in front of them. I'm sorry. With all this fabrication going on and all that crazy stuff, great models, and they have this. I made fun of this object every time I've given a talk for the past, since 1981 when they first built it. It was black and had a mirror so that nobody can play footsie in front of you. Nobody can flirt in the front row. I will have that thing. The only thing which is an improvement, hopefully, which is forward. Left or right?
Right.
It's like the Conservative Party, moving forward. I know, I was up till quite late, but there was no result. Because everything is digital, my office does not possess any of my analog drawings, unfortunately, so it's a kind of last minute improvisation. And the collaboration between my office and the AAs obviously failed. It fails every time. That's why I don't give lectures anymore, because it's a little trauma. I rely on Patrick. You must all know Patrick Schumacher. It's a shame his picture is not next to me on the screen. Brett promised, but Patrick is in Shanghai, where he should stay. I called him, honestly, I don't want to tell stories, and I know I have only 10 minutes to talk, but I called him. I was in America, where I got stuck, which is not necessarily such a bad thing. I called him every day, said, are you sure you don't want me to come to China? Because I don't want you to call me the day before and say you must come tomorrow. He says, oh, no, it really is not necessary to come this time. I called every day. I called him and Roger alternately. Shall I go to China? Shall I go to New York? They all said, don't worry, it's not important. So yesterday, I'm in the middle of a client meeting, and I get a call from Patrick. He never calls. Those who know him, student of his, you know you can never find him. He called and said, can you come to China tomorrow? Which is today, I didn't have a visa. So that's the end of that one. This was done for the show, and I can talk about it because I think that Brett was showing me this model upstairs, and I did this, the exhibition I did there in 83 after I won the peak in Hong Kong was done and worked on in the barrel vaults, so I told Brett not to demolish it. And we used to run up and down the stairs and put, because we were painting and drawing upstairs, we used to fill Perrier bottles with water so we can paint, and everybody thought, oh, that's the trick. Zaha used Perrier for painting. So I just kind of began to see Perrier everywhere in the school. I mean, the sales of Perrier must have quadrupled. And I finally said, no, you can't really use gassy water with a painting. It is salt, fundamentally. So I'm not sure what I'm going to do with these drawings. I think you should collect all the drawings of the studios in that period. And I think it is interesting that when I came to the AA as a student in the mid-70s, drawing technique was zero. There were people before that, some people who, of course, you know, like the Smithsons and sorry, Price and always been fantastic stuff in the archigram, you know, in the 60s. But by the time I got here, it was definitely anti-drawing and anti-design at the same time. And I think it took, let's say, I would say, in those 10 years between 75 and 85, drawing technique had become so sophisticated and elaborate, I mean, a really extraordinary material. And it's all kind of gone. But I think what it did, I don't think that the computing programs are ignorant of that development. And I think it was a precursor for all three 3D drawings which came out later in digital form. Because before there was only a section and a plan and an axonometric, which is an extrusion. And I think what changed because of the research in three-dimensional work, that it was no longer about extrusion, what is also critical is that drawing technique became design technique and became building technique. And I think that is really, the development in the last 3 years in that respect is incredibly exciting and amazing. This is a drawing which was called The World, which was took a long time to construct because many perspectives. And it's a catalog of all the work which was shown at the time at the in the AA. I do have images of this show. I'm sure you have it as well in school, but I have a lot of them. Not too many, but some. Actually, the ones I have are taken by friends of mine, not by AA or of this people in the, were in that team. The team was a mixture of architects and painters, well, many of them textile designers, and textile because they really can do color, and it's very important in this case that they have a very steady hand and very precise ability to draw and of course all the Americans can ink extremely well, and it was almost like doing it through a computer. No crossing lines, no smudging. I did hire once a student from the AA 15 years ago, and we tried very hard to make this girl meet ink line to ink line. And we had every kind of pavement had a nipple, because she couldn't understand the idea of a circle meeting two lines and drawing the ink so it fades off and so on. Now, Brett here is an expert in that department. I did not have the drawing which he worked on. It's a city, one of the image of it. I said, shame, Roger. I have a guy called Roger, but he only responds to me when I speak to him in Spanish. He is English, born in Holland. But I can only respond to me when I call him Roger. Where is he? Anyway, he's not here. He's somewhere hiding. Roger. That sheet on that wood you printed for the room in Madrid. Anyway. And of course, the earlier project, which was about superimposition. So let's say drawing technique matched ideas. So superimposition. And before there was collision, they were superimposed the tectonic on the hung of a bridge on the Thames. So this was finding a kind of scale, and the scale becomes important. A scale program, which was very critical, how to program these buildings and location. Then the 19th Century Museum of Juxtaposition, of existing structure, which is the bridge, the station in London, Charing Cross. So the idea that the train, which is the museum, kind of collapses on the footsteps of the National Theatre and Royal Festival Hall, so it collapses on the footsteps of the 20th century. And I think very early carving. So the carve, which I cannot show much of today in terms of the sketches for the Irish house, which were paper kind of cut out, which led to the reliefs later on. This is kind of the horizontal elevation, appearance of the horizontal elevation, and the carving of the ground, and also superimposition of how things could be layered. Then you can have what we called an X-ray drawing, which had all the levels together. So that led to also idea of archaeology, geology, where you see everything at the same time. This is one of the very first kind of exploded drawings. It's a black and white drawing of the Dutch House of Parliament in The Hague, so the idea of the exploded space or drawing becomes an exploded space, where the battery of or elevators are no longer together, they're separated, that in this building there was a layer which becomes a public or civic domain, but only from a parliamentarian, but they're an area where they can actually have meeting rooms and then connect to another building. So you know, I did that with Rem and Ilya, and when I was their partner for a very short-lived period. And each one of us had a different part of the building, but these kind of connectors, let's say, connected all these separate parts together. So kind of random elevations, the explosion of the interior. Parc de la Villette, which was about explosion in motion, so that it is like a kind of a universe where all the components could be moving around the park. So like the drawing, it explodes in the park. The park is more like a field or like a pastoral terrain, and these things like float around mechanized objects. So these are all the kind of different kind of colliding fields together, these kind of small pieces which move about. Whooshing, so that radiation, which was another very important kind of graphic invention or discovery. So you can actually fade away a whole field, or you can do it with light, or you can do it with color, you can whoosh. The use of black and white, almost reversing, negative, kind of like an x-ray. And also, when you put the layering of color, it changes very drastically. So it's all the idea of fading in watercolor and dotting, it was never airbrushed. Everything we had to do, there was kind of so many, let's say, dogmas. No yellow trace, no crossing of lines, no pencil color, very little, no poche, and no airbrush. Everything which everybody else was using was a dogma. I mean, the students, if my students, if they ever brought a yellow trace, they'll be sitting in a dustbin. That's kind of punishment for the afternoon. Or they had to go and bleach the drawing. Somebody asked me from Pratt and said, apparently I was ruthless as a student. I said, no, I was ruthless to my students. I wasn't ruthless, I was very sweet as a student. And I was pampered by Ely and Rem, and you know, whatever I wanted, they would do. They would climb on the fireplace to hang my drawings, whatever. I didn't know, I was unaware that I could manipulate them, but frankly, I had no idea. I was totally innocent, but I exercised tremendous pressure on students, and they all love me till this day. Well, some of them have not recovered ever, but I still keep in touch with them. They think of these moments very fondly, so I think. So this is there was another method which I have not talked about, which started with Valerie still here. She's there in the middle. It's amazing how people stay in this building for a long time. Sorry, Valerie. Which was, well, the word changed over the years, which was called the tick-tick method. Unfortunately, over time, that word tick-tick became used for other obscene things. But at the time it started, it was all these little like things like diving boards or tick-ticks, which were scattered over, or kind of scattered over the field, random scattering over a field, like the Malevich drawing or kind of all supremacist work. There's very, very early sketches of the Eaton Place house, which was about an architecture, interior architecture. So an architecture within an existing space. The idea of the field that is beyond the boundary of the house, and that you put the entire house on one field using a kind of isometric projection. So the beginning of distortion. So it was the distortion of the drawing led to the distortion of the object or our deformation. Looking at, they've lost this painting. We spent years doing this. We didn't. We have not at the time discovered how to whoosh properly. So we had to mask everything, keep the only the bits which we are painting, and we had to whoosh fast. To whoosh fast, we had to use fairy liquid. They're like bubbles. No, because it requires us as a retarder to the paint. Well, we could use a retarder as well. But the fairy liquid was better than a retarder. I did the same actually at the Guggenheim when I saw the Great Utopia show. We fairy liquided all the floors so that we can glide all the synthetic, all the very big compositions on the wall and on the floor. These were techniques used a lot of by art students. So the idea of actually using technique used by artists or you know, people who kind of painted a field and also graphic techniques together was very interesting. There's another of the drawings where you take the floor of one. So this is showing, taking no longer about a graphic presentation, but it's about a storyline. So this is taking away the floor of the house and showing a kind of vestibule, let's say, as if taking this floor off and showing the two levels above and below with all the objects floating in that space and the wall of the library falling flat as if it's a horizontal elevation. I still think the Irish house sketches are some of the most important sketches which were done, but they don't have them recorded. I was almost going to carry a sketchbook with me here, but I mean, you can't see it from a distance. Because every layer of the sketch was carved or burnt or reinforced with a match, whatever. So maybe one day we'll do a show on sketches, or I'll show it again, filmed. Again, you know, very careful, you know, ink on Mylar, black ink. I also did white ink on Mylar, which was very nice. Of course, it's what do I call, now you see it, now you don't. Also very early aerial views. This is the one in your room, the ground floor. Brett took my drawing. I think they replaced it by a print, but I, knowing my office, they gave him the original and gave me the print. So this was a kind of also, so that idea that it, kind of the carve of the, what do we call the, was a kind of walled garden. This is a very, I love this drawing. It disappeared for a long time. I have it just found now. This was done as Mylar with chalk. It's all black chalk, except some areas in the black ink. It's a composite of all the levels. So this is like one of the very early, kind of very sophisticated X-ray drawing, like seeing everything at the same time. And I think that idea of seeing everything at the same time led to not only transparency, but led to kind of seamlessness in the sense that you didn't know where things began, where they ended. And of course it was also about making the Prime Minister's house informal. So there are two houses, one which is for the state guest, so they have a kind of motel as a guest house where they can play around in the garden, swimming around, and his main house, private quarters and entertainment house. The thing which everybody freaked out about at the time was the tennis court, because it was asymmetrical or irregular. And it was, the idea was that under the pressure of the players, it kind of distorted itself. It wasn't that I was inventing the game of tennis, but that's also maybe possible. And the whole whooshing thing even was also right of then. The aerial views, which became almost a signature of the work, was very early aerial view, where again, you see through the interior, so you remove certain fields, like the roof of the living room, and you show the interiors from above of all these different spaces. And in every case we drew these projects, the items we drew were slightly different, because it was a very elaborate way of showing or sketching or showing these pieces. The very first sketch for the peak, that is when hover over the mountain, more like a horizontal skyscraper, showing the ramp, these chipsets floating on the roof, the ruggedness of the edge of the thing. It is before showing one layer which is floating off, before the different beams became separated and so on. Again, very early drawings of the people. The first time that these two things begin to separate, the two beams, one that became four, then all the, each one showing almost like a cut, like a geology or an archaeology of every level of the peak, and some of them are then drawn together. So they were drawn separately and then drawn together. This is the same drawing, but the fluidity of the field of the interior was also very important, that the interiors, although these beams are rectilinear, beginning to look at idea of the structure, which can allow you to make these very long spans, which is a very ideal structure. The pool, which was like an exercise, striation. These what I call back, these little tick-ticks, walls or diving boards, which appear almost separately. The different layers of two beams and the ramp, which appears, the ramp which brings all the cars into the building. So adjacencies becomes also part of this exercise. The top floor, the ground floor is becoming standard construction, the top floor becoming a verandah with kind of cutouts, the boards cut out of the solid. And this is all the composites together, all the small pieces, as if kind of debris or kind of ruins within the contents of these beams all at the same time. You know, re-representing the kind of the contour lines differently and so on. So in every, I think that the whole invention of representation going, I mean, this thing on the side is not done through a machine. It's literally blacking out everything around the white lines. So the white lines are just voids in the black. Just for the information of the office, this is sideways, supposed to be vertical. What is also very funny is that you see this kind of black bit, without naming any unfortunate architects, people can have copied this, but this is actually the existing site. This is not a thing, building. Anyway, kind of showing the section and whatever. And then I think the next thing, which was to show a sequence of drawings, or to do a sequence of drawing from the minute you see the site all the way through the building, like a movie. So this is before kind of animation. I'm sure animation existed, but all this is done by hand. The divers. I'm not sure this is the final one, or the one which I had done for the competition. I think that's not, that's the one I did for the competition. The other one, the water was not, was flat. looking at the way to rise and how it rises in the mountain. But the idea was that you replace the mountain by this building, and then the building explode again into the mountain. This is the slabs, which is a very complex drawing, made of many, many perspectives, but it shows the story of Kowloon, the bay, the violation of the object on the kind of not only the skyline on the top, but on the field, on the water. The idea of mid-levels with only the towers, and the topography of the mountain. It comes in many variations. So this is in color at some sort of sunset, hence the buildings are orange. The white on black version with some gray, very little color, exaggerating the shadows. So the shadows almost become very predominant. Unfortunately, they don't have the white on the black on white. Then using color, kind of like the red paintings or the yellow paintings, or the idea of the rotation, showing the building rotating across, is also pre-computing. The change of color, so that blue, green, red, separating all the elements, the building of a project, so the structure, the first firewall, the second firewall, the addition of the staircase, so that we go back to idea of lightness and how engineering can kind of make building lighter. The major discovery in this project was not to have a continuous staircase, but to have a shift in the staircase and the walls. This is the original drawings of the rotation. So there's somebody actually sat in the office, peers, and literally took a model and just drew it like that. Very, very early sketches of the Kudam, how it cantilevers on the, and the kind of curved wall, cantilevers all the street. A regular, the irregular grid. Hamburg, where it's again, many, many slabs. So the Kudam created other like slab beds, very small. So to make a very small building, we had to kind of really reinvent circulation so that you can actually have space to use. Similar technique, which is rotation. These were actually done, these were not by Patrick. The drawing, I mean the graphic was a project. So there are different views of the same. The cut in the ground, which is in this sketch for Düsseldorf, which led to idea of research and structure, the impregnation of the ground. The ground project really started with that and Tommy Gaia. Collision of volumes. This is done more or less at the same time as the second version of Vitra, the Vitra fire station. Again, going back always from the object to the field, constantly going back from kind of really almost observing the site. These very elaborate large drawings had to do with all that, the urbanism of the site condition interpretation. Nothing eventually they got really kind of sucked into the building. So this is kind of also the building almost streaming from the landscape into the side of the Vitra. Another technique was kind of not just drawing, but relief models with the perspectival, so it's kind of relief 3D. They become actually very similar to the end image. Some of the early Vitra images, area view of the actual building. It is done almost now, 18 years ago. Kind of contours, or I'm skipping many projects in between. Kind of looking at the like contours, landscape, figure ground. all very different techniques. Like, you know, this is a figure ground, which you don't show the whole building, but just show one side, one line. So it's all aligned, everything which is aligned, or one side of the building. You know, looking at these kind of things fading away. Again, carving, this is positive, negative, so in model form, all the different layers of Reina Sofia. So doing simultaneously, showing it as a mass carved out, or as each layer being the negative, like a kind of, almost like a remains of a body overlaying over each other. Model technique, which is using also, like the drawings, strata, so that every layer is almost like a kind of a contour line, so the whole product becomes like a contour. Many different techniques. I think this was soap. I could be wrong, but we tried everything, you know, plexi soap, glass, paper. Yeah, I think this is soap. So then it becomes kind of floating piece. Then mixing maybe plexi with solid. The Rome project. Very early sketches of, you know, looking at, we looked at also technique of doing parallel volumes to the street, but then to break all that, different plans. This was done by Oliver. That's when it's really the whole idea of the grid and the courtyards in Rome changed to then in this interpretation. It took many takes. For example, if we do a sketch for like a project, it might take 2 years for us to know how to interpret that sketch into a project. Not the same project, maybe another project, for example. This idea of destruction started maybe in the Islamic Muse, and in Qatar took maybe 2 years to know how to do it. There's a finished project. Well, not finished, phase one. But I don't think they'll do the second phase, but we'll see. So this is kind of many, what we call many streams. It's like a delta, where each of these things is like a stream, and these streams kind of cross and intersect. And separate. So by bifurcation, they create courtyards. When they intersect, they kind of also act as a stable force engineering-wise. Some of these early drawings, I know every of these lines is a different color. I shifted at some point in time to do a color and white and white on black. And how you interpret this idea of the striation into these louvers, and because of the geometry of the site, in a way this is a very contextual project, because of the geometry, it aligned with every kink in the existing geometry. Wherever you are around it, you can always see one of the pieces addressing it, sort of thing. So these are kind of like always crossing each other. The 2-3-story volume, almost like a drawing. It's almost like a drawing done in a building. So it's a kind of very graphic space. Also black and white in this case, like the drawing. Concrete on the outside. Paint on the asset, and to these relief models, how they are presented in the ceiling, because it's a completely daylit museum. This was a performance for the opening, and it opens again in 3 weeks' time with the art. So you see also in the building the different layers from the terracing of the galleries to the layers of all the buildings. So it's like almost reinventing a segment of Rome, but not over 1,000 years, but over few years or few minutes. Looking out from the top space back into the city, it's not a mural, it's literally a photograph of the adjacent site. And I'll just show you some installations we've done where the idea of distorting one more time the actual project in a show. So this was a deformation, total deformation of the Istanbul master plan, which is already distorted on a wall. It's more compressed. It's already compressed in the real project, but it's more compressed. And we did that very often before, where we would do these exercises and it has an impact on the project again. It takes one back to these images of Pyramid in Leicester Square, dripping from the ceiling, vertical skyscrapers upside down. I'm just showing you kind of some of these interpretations from the actual sketch to an object, but they're small objects. And these are experiments for a show we're doing possibly in Zurich about ourselves and suprematism, where we interpret some of these suprematist drawings or our drawings superimposed in a gallery. So it's no longer just on a wall, but actually the entire space. You superimpose a whole image on all the walls. I should go through them quickly. So that is like a kaleidoscope. I see it from the outside, zooming into the interior, the idea of the exploded image of some of the Russian work. I work for the Great Utopia show, or stretching it on a wall. Kind of neon installations, sofas covered in Malevich's. Unfortunately, I think suprematism and cowhide doesn't gelatino together. It looks like it might be quite nice for these animals to be decorated. They might not like it, but set an outfit for them. The kind of Z play on the wall. Anyway, these are just kind of tests of what how we can combine maybe drawings and furniture together as if it's a shadow. We go back to the idea of the shadow, but like the shadow from the painting is superimposed permanently on the actual object. Black and white, and the peak on one end of the sofa instead of whooshing to the wall. And I just end up with these images from Rome, how the kind of aerial views and the exploration and drawing really led to these kind of projects.